In 1976, Jim Boeheim started his first season as head coach at Syracuse with one of the most important recruits in program history. A valuable sixth man most of his freshman year, a skinny kid from Withrow High School in Cincinnati, became a three-year starter and part of a dynamic duo on and off the court, eight seasons in the NBA, and over 20 years in coaching. Louis Orr, then and now, is a Syracuse legend.
Welcome to Syracuse Legends. I'm Mark Larson. Louis Orr has been called one of the most important recruits in Syracuse basketball history, and the numbers back it up. Louis helped new head coach Jim Boeheim to 100 wins and only 18 losses in his first four seasons. Louis is a man of faith, family, and friendship who believes destiny led him to play basketball at Syracuse University.
My recruitment to Syracuse was really somewhat unique, a unique story. It was totally the hand of God. It was a blessing. It was divine intervention. Back then, you only had a late signing period. And I was getting recruited. You know, coach likes to say I didn't have any scholarships, but I had some. I took four or five official visits. You know, I had a friend, a typical friend of a friend of a friend story. And he kind of mentored me. And he was in the business of basketball. So he called a few schools. And Syracuse was one of them because he knew one of the Syracuse alums. Rick Pitino was the first Syracuse coach to come down and watch me work out in an open gym situation after my high school season. I was actually against some NBA prospects. Coach Boeheim actually came down, and it's funny because Xavier was recruiting me. Xavier University was recruiting me and had been for a long time, and I was close to going there. And I used to go over there and play open gym after the season. And coach actually went to Xavier in their gym and watched me play against Xavier players and some other players from the area. So that's really the one time that coach saw me play. So, and then Rick Pitino was the last coach to come down to see me play. We played the Russians, and he was in the stands. And after the game, he had scholarship papers, and I said, well, I really don't want to do it here. I said, let's go. Can you come by my house in the morning? My father and everybody will be there. The funny story is he came into my house, and my father, he had a kind of a dry sense of humor sometimes, but he came in and sat down, and he told him, my son not going to Syracuse. What are you coming here for? Something like that. And he was just joking, and he said, I'm just fooling with you. And Rick kind of got on his heels a little bit, but so I signed. Great school, great basketball program. So that's how it started. I really didn't know much about the East Coast high school basketball. I'm from the Midwest. I was the only guy from the Midwest, from Cincinnati, but Roosevelt being from Kendall, the Rochester area, I was kind of I don't know if you call it an outsider, but I really wasn't from this part of the country. So I knew I had to go up there and earn my stripes. I was not a heavily recruited young guy, and I was hungry. We would have an open gym, and we would. Back then, coach would only let us play 4-on-4, half court. As I got older, I understood because it taught you how to play together. And Coach Boeheim was good. He wasn't a guy that was like, hey. I got these other guys that maybe are area guys or highly recruited guys, so I'm gonna put them out there first. The guys that he trusted and he thought earned the playing time would play. I just wanted to get on the court, get in where you can fit in, and that was my thing. Then my sophomore year was probably my toughest year. My dad, who was a big proponent for me to go away to school, to go to Syracuse, and he had found a lump on his neck. One thing led to another, and they found that he had lung cancer. And I went away to school as a sophomore, and I thought it was more of the surgery was, nothing's routine when you're dealing with cancer, but had the surgery, came in recovery and never really pulled out of it, and he passed away. So that was right when practice had started. You know, that I got probably the toughest phone call I ever got, you know, early that morning from my mother. It was a tough year. I was a long way from home, you know, and going through losing my dad was tough, and, you know, really my family, and I hadn't quite adjusted to being in Syracuse socially and personally. The basketball part, you know, that basketball is basketball, you know, so, but just being away from home and going through that, you know, it was tough. I talked to Coach a little bit, and I talked to my brothers, Lindsay and Ed, and I said, hey, you know, you gotta stick with what you know. And my mother, she had my other two brothers there. She lived by herself, but, you know, it was the best thing for me, was to come back. As a person, too, I grew up a lot. I took my braces off. And I kind of embraced Syracuse more. You know, before I felt like I was, as far as the school and being there, I couldn't wait to go home all the time. Couldn't wait to go since I go home. But I think I embraced the school more in a lot of different ways. And, you know, it's been a great home away from home for me.
His father's sage advice to stay at Syracuse helped Lewis to a career that later led to 8 seasons in the NBA.
Up next, the Louie and Bowie Show becomes part of Orange lore.
God had Syracuse in my life for a reason, you know, and playing with Roosevelt for a reason, and all my teammates.
Teammates in life and in basketball, when Syracuse Legends continues.
When Lewis Orr and Roosevelt Bowie came to Syracuse in 1976 as part of Jim Boeheim's first recruiting class, they became forever linked in the annals of Syracuse history and in the hearts of Orange fans everywhere.
Orr in the corner to Bowie. He's wide open. Slam dunk.
All right, the alley-oop pass to Bowie from Orr, and that ties the game.
They got the high-low stack on the right side. Alley-oop to Bowie. Yes, a honey from Lewis Orr to Roosevelt Bowie.
I remember all of us meeting as a team, and I met Roosevelt, and, you know, I see this tall guy with a big afro, and, you know, I had heard about him, you know, big 7-footer, and along with the other freshmen, Howe Corn and Cliff Warwell, and the whole team, we have our meeting and everything, and I'm pretty quiet, Rosie's pretty quiet, so, you know, you meet and you greet, and our relationship probably definitely was a progression. You know, in terms of opening up, getting to know each other. And I think as time went on, we drew closer and closer. And then I think it was my last 2 years, we were neighbors. So as neighbors, I think we got closer and we got to know each other as people. We were in and out of each other's apartments and eating each other's food. His mother was a great, you know, people used to send him cakes, and he had cakes and stuff, and he had a sweet tooth, and I'd eat there, and I'd have care packages, and we'd be back and forth, but we kind of shared what we had. But that's when our relationship really took off, and we played more together, that's where it grew. But we always had mutual respect for each other. We always had a bond, and our mutual respect. And I think the respect is the foundation of our relationship. Because we were young and going through a lot of the same things together. You know, we played a little bit against each other somewhat, but we played together and then ourselves for him. So we learned to respect each other's strengths. And we, the more comfortable we got as student athletes, as freshmen, as people, the closer we get.
Cohen at the point, high post, Lewis Orr.
I really think our junior and senior year, that's when it took off. I think that's where the bond between Roosevelt and myself worked, because we used to work a high-low offense with Coach Boeheim, and he still does it now.
Dad, these are two talented teams. All right, the alley-oop pass to Bowie. from Orr, and that ties the game. Orr and Bowie put on the Louis Bowie show to tie.
A lot of times I was at that high post, especially my junior and senior year, and more so my senior year, and we just got a thing where when I got it, I knew I'd look before he was even there. And I knew he'd be open and it'd be boom, boom. You know, I'd get him the ball. And we worked that. And we looked for each other. And Rose was such a great shot blocker. You know, you knew he had your back. But the year when myself, Roosevelt, and Del Shackelford were the front line, you know, we were really good at getting Roosevelt the ball in places where he could be effective. And Rosie was great at having our back, blocking shots and rebounding. And we really shared the ball well. So that kind of built our relationship on the court, playing together. And then us living and being neighbors with one another helped off the court action.
To the high post, Louis. To the low post, Bowie. Up and good.
I saw a picture. It was an artwork of our team. And it was great. I think I got a copy of it. It got me with like my belly sticking out, looking real thin, and Rosie with his hair, and then Del Shackelford giving us five. I remember as freshmen, we played against Ernie and Bernie. Maybe that kind of put that thought in mind, you know, Bowie and Louis and Bowie, however you want to put it, because I've seen it both ways, you know, and I'm fine with that. Bowie and Louis and Bowie, however. And then as we progressed as players, and we got that rhythm on the court, you know, it was a natural fit. And I know there was an artwork or cartoon in the newspaper, whatever, that used that, but I don't know exactly how it got started, but it caught on, and it's a privilege and an honor, you know, being identified with Roosevelt in such a way, because he was a big part of my life and my career.
Orr and Bowie put on the Louis Bowie show.
When I see the picture, I just think, you know, that's my partner, and we were in stride when we played together, you know. And really, you know, there was no competition, no animosity. You know, we were partners, you know. And on the court, that's where the bond was really strongest. You know, we didn't always socialize together. We had different interests. I'm a city guy, Roosevelt. Born kind of more in the rural area. He was into fishing and outdoor stuff. I'd never really hardly been fishing and all that, so his interests were different.
Inside, or up and good! The number two team in the country is showing them how right now.
But on the court, you know, we had a rhythm together and we trusted each other. But it wasn't competitive. It was a mutual respect, and we know we needed each other, and we grew up together. You know, we grew together. So when I see the picture of us running down the court together, it exemplifies our bond on the court. And it's my favorite photograph.
When the curtain dropped in 1980 on the Louis and Bowie show, Louis had accumulated almost 1,500 points and 260 assists, many of them to his teammate and trusted friend from Kendall, New York.
When Syracuse Legends continues.
He appreciated the way me as a player and as a person, and the same as a coach.
Coaching for and against his Hall of Fame mentor.
Louis Orr and Jim Boeheim. There's a unique bond between these two men on three levels. Orr played for, coached for, and has coached against his Hall of Fame mentor. It's a relationship that is as strong today as it was in 1976 when the coach recruited the kid from Cincinnati.
From the very start with Coach Boeheim, the one thing I can say, you know, he saw something in me, you know, from the very beginning. He appreciated, I think, how I played the game. Coach appreciates your knowledge of the game. He knew I was a student of the game. I competed. I was a team guy. You know, back then, No one averaged 20 points a game. I don't know who the first player was to average 20 for Coach. You know, it was always a balanced attack, guys that knew how to play. But from the very beginning, you know, Coach and I had a very good relationship, and I think sort of an adult relationship where we could communicate, we could talk, you know. And you know, he would push me at times when I needed to be pushed. But, you know, for the most part, you know, we could talk. And, you know, I think about it at times. I've been over his house, and we had a relationship like that. You know, I may go in his office and sit down and talk to him. I remember my dad died, and I went to practice that day, and I was shook up. I said, hey, you know, my father just passed, and I need to go home. You know, and you know, he was understanding about it. And I think, I could be wrong, but I think his mom might have passed the same year. So he went through a trying time. But all along, we've had a relationship where we could communicate and as people. And then when I got into coaching, I started with Pete Gillen. I was at Xavier University as a volunteer, then he hired me full time, and then he left Xavier and went to Providence, and I went with him to Providence for 2 years. You know, and then when Wayne Morgan got the head job at Iowa State here at Syracuse, he left Syracuse, Coach called me and asked me, you know, would I be interested in coming to Syracuse and being an assistant. You know, he thought it'd be a good fit. And I love Pete. Pete's got me into coaching. He been good to me and really introduced me and taught me a lot about college coaching and recruiting and all that. So it wasn't an easy thing, but having a chance to coach at your alma mater and be part of the man that coached you in college, be part of his staff, it was just, to me, a once-in-a-lifetime experience. You know, it was a great opportunity. So I left Providence and went to Syracuse, and working with him, a lot of the same. You know, we had a mutual respect for each other, and he allowed me to be Lewis Orr. And I thought that was a part of as a player. You know, he appreciated the way me as a player and as a person, and the same as a coach. You know, he let me teach. He allowed me the opportunity to work with the players. He allowed me the opportunity to spend time with the players off the court, you know, to mentor and to really be a hands-on coach. And coach is not a micromanager as far as coaches go, in my opinion. You know, he wants guys that he can trust to do their job. He's not going to look over your shoulder all the time. You know what he wants, he tells you what he wants, but he allows you to basically take care of your business. And I like that, because I had my own relationship with the players, and it was great. It was great. I could be closer to the guys that I coached those 4 years at Syracuse as assistant than any group at any time in my 20 years of coaching. And Coach allowed me that freedom. So it carried over to coaching in our relationship and to this day. When I got here to coach, really everyone on the staff was a graduate of Syracuse University. It becomes more personal when it's your alma mater. And you just feel like it's more to it than just basketball. You know, you representing the school that you got your degree from. And this was a huge part of my life, my 4 years at Syracuse. It's where I went from being really a teenager to a man. I matured here, you know, and it was my home away from home. So when I got a chance to coach and move back to Syracuse as an adult with my family, my wife Yvette, my daughter Monica, my son Chauncey, I was a dad, I was a husband, and I lived in the community. I wasn't just a student that was there and then went home in the summers. So it was a whole different dynamic. And then working with Bernie and Mike Hopkins as assistants, it was just that bond of being alum.
The pupil learned from the teacher.
Well, he's learned plenty. He went to Tobacco Road and won against North Carolina State.
Coaching against Coach and coming back to the Dome was incredible. I mean, it brought tears to my eyes. I mean, the fans were unbelievable, you know. And seeing Coach and Mike and Bernie on the other side and talking to them before the game, it was emotional. And you know, we didn't fare great early. I think three or four games in a row, I think we lost. And then it was, you know, I know how competitive Coach is. So, you know, you put everything else out the window. You know, he won't win every game, and me too. So, and afterwards, we can hug and be friends.
A win at the Carrier Dome for Seton Hall.
Lewis took the lessons he learned as a player and coach under Jim Boeheim and went on to spend 13 seasons as a head coach at Siena, Seton Hall, and Bowling Green.
When we come back, Lewis Orr's emotional homecoming.
I'd like to thank you fans. You loved me and hugged me and made me feel home.
Two legendary jerseys make their first appearance in the Carrier Dome.
Or faith and family are the foundation of a life well lived, and it's his commitment to faith that has guided Lewis through his life's journey.
I was going through some personal struggles and basketball, and I was just in the NBA, and you know, as a young man in the NBA, you got a lot of temptations out there, and I just remember watching TV and watching a TV evangelist, Jimmy Swaggart. I know who it was. I was sitting in my apartment in Cincinnati and I just broke down and cried. And my faith, I think my relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ was confirmed then. And from that point on, it's been the foundation of my life, you know, and it's really carried me through every situation. And you know, he's ordered my steps. And when I look back and I've seen, even when I wasn't faithful with him, he's been faithful with me. I want everything that I do, whether it's basketball or whatever, to be really glorify him. Now I fall short, but as a coach, as a person, it's really, you know, you want to be an ambassador. And I look at basketball coaching as a tool, an instrument that the Lord has given me to really give him the glory. So for those that think it's overdone, it's not. You know, God is good and he's been great to me, so I give him the glory.
To God be the glory. You know, every good and perfect gift comes from the Lord, and I'm thankful, I'm humble.
Having your jersey retired, I don't know, it's just such a humbling thing. I never really looked at myself in that sense, because you know, you always been part of a team, you know, and you always look at basketball as a team sport. And
I'd like to thank Coach Boeheim for really giving me an opportunity and recognizing whatever it was that he saw, and just to thank my teammates.
I've always been a team guy, you know, and the one thing I knew about our experience at Syracuse, Rose and mine, is we were a team, you know, and we had other really good players playing with us, and you know, it was always a team game, you know. But the one thing, if that was going to happen to me, and God was going to allow that blessing to occur, I couldn't ask for a better guy to go up in the rafters with than Roosevelt Booth. You know, a guy that I came in with, a guy that I went to war with, that I battled with, and who I'm friends with. You know, Rosie's a loyal guy, and he's a warrior. You know, he's a warrior. You know, he's a guy that I always knew. And not just in basketball, but in life, he had my back, you know. And he's a guy you can count on, you know. But humble, team guy, never complained, you know. And, you know, it was just an honor to be connected with him in every way, you know. So to share this experience with Roosevelt, it was a blessing. To be able to have my family, my wife Yvette, and my daughter Monica, my son Chauncey, my grandson Isaiah, and other members of my family there, it was just it was a great honor. And I'm appreciative, and I know that we're in great company. But you never do anything by yourself. It's always, basketball is a team sport. So, I credit the guys I play with and the coaches. Really, when one number goes up there, we all go. Because we all accomplish things together.
It's one of the great honors for any legendary athlete, having your jersey retired. And for Louie and Bowie, that day came on February 21st, 2015. 35 years after their last game for the Orange. With the number 55 jersey now hanging high above Jim Boeheim Court, Louis Orr is now home, and his father would be proud. Thanks for joining us on this edition of Syracuse Legends. Until next time, I'm Mark Larson.